morning, everybody. Hi. Welcome. And it's good to see you. Oh, hopefully you're feeling well fed and watered. And thanks to Val and Stephen for cooking up breakfast for us this morning. We see that. Well, we're going to sing a song together. You're all looking a little bit lethargic. So we're going to hit you up and hit you with a little bit. God is going to come and lead this song for us.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
There's a
hand. Okay.
Yeah, go ahead.
Come in, hear me. Come in, Noah. Is it
How old are you today, Noah?
Are you one? Are you one? Two?
Five.
Wow, that's really big. We're going to sing happy birthday, is that okay? Yeah, we'll sing happy birthday? Yes. All right, here goes.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Noah. Happy birthday to you.
Very good. Happy birthday. Let's pray together, shall we? Father, we want to thank you for this opportunity to gather here today to spend this time together. Lord, thank you that you're good. Thank you that you love us. Lord, in these moments that we have, would you remind us just how great your love is for each one of us. But we ask it all in the name of Jesus. Amen. Well, at this time, the children are going to leave us to go through to children's church. And so we need some adults first. Whoa. So if you're in primary school or below, then there's lots of good qualities. And if you're not, then there's lots of qualities for us. A few notices, things that are coming up today. First of all, we're jumping into a new series for the next, I'll take you through the next 7 weeks, called The Journey of Grace. And we're going to be thinking about all about discipleship and the journey that we take from no faith to new faith to maturing faith. And that'll be the topic of our Sunday gatherings. When we meet like this on a Sunday morning. But we also have 3 groups that are running through the week. 3 Bible study groups to help us dig a little bit deeper into what we're talking about each week. One of those is going to be on a Sunday afternoon at 4:30 here in the building. One of those is going to be on a Wednesday morning at 11 o'clock here in the building. And then there's another group that is on Wednesday evening at 7 o'clock. And so you have options, and we want to encourage you to join in and participate and choose one of those options so that we can journey together through this next 7 weeks. Another thing to mention, next weekend on Friday night and on Saturday, there's a conference, a 24/7 prayer, annual gathering. It's being broadcast online. So we're going to create some space to watch a little bit of that here on the Friday evening and part of the day on Saturday. So let me know if you'd be interested in that at all. We'll put it on the screen and we can sit and watch together and participate in those kinds of worship and teaching together. But that'd be a really good opportunity to spend some time together and to worship and to grow together as well. All the information is in your bulletin. Hopefully you've picked up a bulletin on your way in. If not, hopefully there are some spares. I see some spares that you can grab one of those and there's a few other bits of information as well. So make sure you pick up one of those and I'll tell you everything that you need to know at least for the next couple of weeks. We're going to read a few verses together. There's a scene in, have you seen the film or read the book? I think the book came first. Romeo and Juliet? Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah, the book came first. It's definitely the resident writer. Yeah.
Sure.
But then there's a scene in it where this question is posed, what's in the name? Right? And what's the response? Does anyone know the response? A rose by any other name would still smell as sweet. As if to say, the name doesn't really matter. That's a context of the story. Two feuding families with different names, but really does the name matter? But actually, what we find in the Bible is that names really do matter. Not in the sense that they should divide us, but names matter. Names are important. Names mean something. Names carry some weight. Right? So I wanted to read these verses together that pop up on the screen. Here are some different things that the Bible says about the Lord's name. So let's read. The name of the Lord is a strong tower.
The righteous run into it and are safe.
Pray like this.
Our Father in heaven, may your name be kept holy.
Salvation is found in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven given to mankind
by which we must be saved.
Therefore, God exalted him to the highest place of Jesus and gave him the name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow and every tongue acknowledge that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father.
For us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government will be on his shoulders, and he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace.
I am the Lord, that is my name. Therefore go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. The name of the Lord matters. So I want to invite you to stand, if you're able to stand. Let's sing a couple of songs.
Blessed be the name of the Lord. 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 Oh, the name of the Lord is a strong tower. Christ is running into it. They are saved. Down.
Endless praise,
I can just say, I don't know how many people know about us having to kind of make investigations regarding...
I'm not sure how many people know what about the house situation. We've been renting a house for about 6 years, and we recently advised the landlord would like to sell the house. But we've been investigating the possibility of buying the house ourselves, and things are going well so far, I can have to say. We've kind of got kind of a price agreed. Formal and hoping to get that formalised in the coming days. So, and thank God to progress so far and to continue to pay that everything in the months and smoothly with more application and things. So, we've got it happening so far.
Watched it yesterday.
You watched it yesterday. Dennis and Menace and Mr. Wilson is the story of a young boss. There he is. Looks lovable. a young boy, Dennis, who lives next door to an elderly couple, retired couple, Mr. and Mrs. Wilson. And Dennis's young boy is particularly taken with Mr. Wilson. Loves him. Thinks he's amazing. Mr. Wilson thinks Dennis is a menace. Right? And does everything in his power to avoid Dennis, to stay out of the way. Because the trouble is, as innocent and as inquisitive and naive as Dennis is, he always seems to cause some. There's one story in particular, this story actually, where Mr. Wilson is in bed pretending to be ill and pretending to be asleep so that he doesn't have to engage with or interact with Dennis at all. And there's a funny little scene that with Dennis kind of feeling his head when he's a little bit warm, he could do with some aspirin. So he finds the aspirin. Then, of course, he tries to shove an aspirin in Mr. Wilson's mouth, but Mr. Wilson pulls his mouth tight shut and doesn't want the aspirin. And so, what do you do if you can't
get it in with your fingers, you use your slingshot. So he puts his ass in the slingshot and pulls it back, and waits until Mr. Wilson's story means that his mouth opens up and shoots the ass right into the back of his throat. Which waits for that, of course. But it's a funny film. You'd recommend it.
I would.
It's a funny film, but it's a fascinating interaction between these two characters. This young boy, just in awe of the world around him, captivated by everything that's going on, and this old man who's been there and done that, and won a t-shirt, and just wants to enjoy his retirement in peace. And it's a fascinating comparison between that and the story that we're going to think a little bit about today from the Bible. And the film is about Dennis and Mr. Wilson. We're going to think a little bit about Zechariah and Mary from the Christmas story. Right? I know it's only up to them. But we're going to have a little think about Zechariah, the old prince, and Mary, this young girl. And we've got a couple of passages from the Bible that I'd like us to read. I need a couple of volunteer readers. Anyone want to come and read for us? It's all printed out, so we don't need to do everything. I need two people. Okay, there's one over there. Anyone else? Marcia? Marvelous.
This is Luke 1, verses 11 to 20. While Zechariah was in the sanctuary, an angel of the Lord appeared to him, standing to the right of the incense altar. Zechariah was shaken and overwhelmed with fear when he saw him. But the angel said, "Don't be afraid, Zechariah. God has heard your prayer. Your wife Elizabeth will give you a son, and you are to name him John. You have great joy and gladness, and many will rejoice in his birth, for he will be great in the eyes of the Lord. He must never touch wine or other alcoholic drink. He will be filled with the Holy Spirit, even before his birth. And he will turn many Israelites to the Lord their God. He will be a man with the spirit and power of Elijah. He will prepare the people for the coming of the Lord. He will turn the hearts of the fathers to their children, and he will cause those who are rebellious to accept the wisdom of the Godhead." Zechariah said to the angel, "How can I be sure this will happen? I'm an old man now, and my wife is also well along in years." Then the angel said, "I am Gabriel. I stand in the very presence. It was he who sent me to bring you this good news. But now, since you didn't believe what I said, you will be silent and unable to speak until the child is born. For my words will certainly be fulfilled at that time."
Chapter 1, 29 to 38. Confused and disturbed, Mary tried to think what the angel could mean. "Don't be afraid, Mary," the angel told her, "for you have found favor with God. You will conceive and give birth to a son, and you will name him Jesus. He will be very great and will be called the Son of the Most High. The Lord God will give him the throne of his ancestor David, and he will reign over Israel forever. His kingdom will never end." Mary asked the angel, "But how can this happen? I'm a virgin." The angel replied, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. So the baby to be born will be holy, What's more, you're relatively visible. People used to say she was barren, but she has conceived a son and is now in her 6th month. For the word of God will never fail. Mary responded, I am the Lord's servant. May everything you've said about me be found to me. And then he went to her.
Thank you. So we have these two parallel stories. Right, we have Zechariah, the old man, the old priest. And I've always wondered, I don't know about you, but I've always wondered why he gets struck down. Right, but he asks this question. The angel comes to both of them, to Zechariah and to Mary. And announces this life-changing news, right? And for Zechariah, it's something that he's been praying for with his wife. It's something that he's longed for so many years. But for Mary, it's completely out of the blue. But the angel appears to both of them, gives them this life-changing news: you're gonna have a baby. And Zechariah's response is this: how can I be sure this will happen? How can I be sure that this will happen? Mary's response is, I mean, it sounds quite similar, doesn't it? Mary's response is this: how can this be? Here's the difference, and here's why I think Zechariah was struck down. Mary doesn't get it. No. Mary's young enough, childlike enough, Christ-like enough, perhaps, to still be inquisitive and naive and hopeful. And she listens to the angel, and yes, she's filled with fear, right? The angel says, but we're afraid. But she's also filled with awe and wonder and amazement. She says, well, may everything you have said come true. Why? Because she's amazed by it all. Her question, how can this be? It is a question of, it's the Dennis question or the child question of why? If you're a parent, you've heard that. Yeah, it lasts a little bit longer. It's just assumed that I've been there a while. It's an inquisitive question. Zechariah was old enough, experienced enough, knowledgeable enough. I don't want to say he was a grumpy old man, because he was a priest, and if you really said that, he was faithful. He had served God faithfully for many years. But when the angel shared this news, he doesn't believe it. And so actually his question, this question isn't a question of being inquisitive. It's not a question of why, or I don't understand who will explain that to you. Zechariah challenges the angel. Prove it. How can this happen? I don't believe it. Faced with of an angel, he challenges this news. Mary's young, too familiar yet. Somehow for Zechariah, it's all become just too familiar, too routine. And so whereas Mary is filled with awe and wonder, Zechariah challenges the whole thing. The chapter goes on, the story goes on, and we're all familiar. We're all familiar, aren't we, with the way that Mary responds. You know, Mary has the magnificence. Oh, how I praise the Lord, how I rejoice in God my Saviour, that He took notice of this lovely servant, and now generation after generation will call me blessed. We all know that, right? Perhaps in different words. We don't often hear what happened to Zechariah after John had been born, after he received his speech back. But actually, if you look to the end of chapter 1, from verse 67, Zechariah is filled with the Holy Spirit and gives the word of God. And you can read the whole thing, but just towards the end of it, the last couple of verses say this: because of God's tender mercy, the morning light from heaven is about to break upon us to give light to those who sit in darkness and in the shadow of death, and to guide us to the path. God of God's tender mercy, the morning light from heaven is about to break upon us. Jesus is coming. To give light to those who sit in darkness and in the shadow of death. Spot back to the Old Testament. And to guide us to the path of peace. See, there's a path. Where, whether we're old or whether we're young, whether your faith is new, or whether it's well established, there's a path, there's a way to go, a way to walk, a way to live our lives. Zechariah, you can almost sense in these verses, can't you, that he's recaptured something that has gotten lost through the years. As he speaks about God's tender mercy, you can feel him almost brushing off all the kind of familiarity and the tradition and all of that stuff that has just increasingly weighed you down through the years. As he speaks about the morning light from heaven, you can feel him kind of experiencing that lightness of spirit himself. He's recapturing something that has gotten lost through the years. And it's not age that has made him that way. Despite perhaps his best effort and intentions, it's the path he's taken that is loving that way. Jesus says these words, let's read them together, they'll be on the screen, from John chapter 14. Jesus answered, I am the way and the truth. And the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. There is a path of peace that Zechariah talked about. There's a way to go, there's a way to live our lives. Actually, if we want to discover the way, we find it in Jesus. He is the way. He is the truth. He is the life. Many years ago, Thomas Aquinas wrote a book of the Imitation of Christ. This is what he says, reflecting on these verses, paraphrases these verses. He says, follow me, way there is no going. Without the truth, there is no knowing. Without the life, there is no living. I am the way which you want to follow. The truth which you want to trust. The life which you want to hope for. I am the way inviolable. The truth infallible. The light that cannot end. If you remain in my way, you shall know the truth, and the truth shall set you free. And you shall lay all the things right on that. In Jesus, you find the way to the Father. He is the way home. In Jesus, we find the truth. He embodies the unchanging, sure, and certain truth of the character and nature of the Father. In Jesus, we find life, abundant life, both now and in the Christ new creation of God to come. As we journey through life as people of faith, there is a way to go. There is a truth to hold on to, and a life to be lived. And life is a journey, right? Following Jesus is a journey. Discipleship is a journey from no faith to new faith to mature faith. It's a journey of grace where God offers us everything we need for the moment, including his very presence, if we're faithful, to guide us along that path of peace. And that's the journey that we're going to be walking and exploring over this next few weeks as we think about this journey of grace to understand what it means to be disciples and to make disciples. I've been in the church a long time. Not as long as I've been following Jesus, or trying to follow Jesus, for many years. And I don't want to walk along a path that causes me to lose that joy and awe and wonder and amazement that Mary had. I don't want to take the path that leads to routine and familiarity. I want to take the path of peace. Because that's the way. Thank you, Lord, for your grace, which runs after us, which saves us, which sustains us, your grace which sanctifies us, makes us new every day. Lord, I pray that in these moments, but also in these weeks that lie ahead, the way of Jesus. Lord, I pray that we would walk that way with Jesus. Lord, thank you that you don't just give us instructions and tell us what to do and send us off on our way, but you invite us to walk with you on this journey of faith, this journey of grace, this journey of life. So Lord, I pray that you would open our hearts in these moments to receive you, to receive your love, to receive your life, to receive your truth, to walk with you. So we ask you in the name of Jesus. We're going to sing in just a moment, but before we do, we're going to watch a little.
Discipleship is a journey of grace with Jesus as our guide and companion. This journey lasts a lifetime as we grow into an ever-increasing relationship with God. It begins as God prepares the path before us through prevenient grace. His hand reaches out and beckons us to Him. This grace both precedes our response and enables our response. Next, Jesus rescues us from sin through saving grace and leads us into the truth that sets us free. When we accept Him, He redeems us, makes us a new creation, and adopts us into His family. Finally, the Holy Spirit empowers us to live a life fully consecrated to God. Sanctifying grace begins the moment we experience salvation. Initial sanctification is followed by spiritual growth in grace until, in a moment of full consecration and complete surrender on our part, God purifies and cleanses the heart. We are all on this journey together. Christ calls His followers to a journey with others, from no faith to new faith to mature faith. Invite others to join you on your journey by sharing the story of God's grace in your life with others. To learn more, visit Nazarene.org/journey.
So let's stand together, shall we? We're going to sing "This Is Amazing Grace."
Thank you. draw people back to you. So Lord, I pray that you would give us eyes to see all the places that you're at work and all the things that you're doing all around us. Lord, I pray that you would give us the courage that we need to link out our religion to follow you. Whatever that looks like, whatever that means, wherever that takes us, that you're doing.